आदाब, मैं हूं महताब और आप देख रहे हैं द वायर। द वायर के इस खास प्रोग्राम इन दिनों में आज हम बात करेंगे एक सियासी शख्सियत की, उस सियासी शख्सियत के बारे में जिनके कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशंस तो बहुत हैं, जिन्होंने नेशन बिल्डिंग के लिए और इंडियन पॉलिटिक्स में भी उनका बड़ा कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन है, लेकिन उनके कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशंस के बारे में बहुत कम बात होती है, या ये कहना भी मुनासिब होगा कि लगभग नहीं के बराबर बातचीत होती है। जी हाँ, हम बात कर रहे हैं हिंदुस्तान के 11वें प्राइम मिनिस्टर एचडी देवगौड़ा की। एचडी देवगौड़ा आज से 25 साल पहले यानी 1996 में हिंदुस्तान के 11वें प्राइम मिनिस्टर के तौर पर उन्होंने ओथ लिया, जब हमारा मुल्क अपनी आज़ादी के 50वां साल सेलिब्रेट कर रहा था। हम आज़ादी जश्न आज़ादी मना रहे थे, उस वक्त उन्होंने लाल किले से भाषण दिया और बहुत कम मुद्दत के लिए वो प्राइम मिनिस्टर रहे, लेकिन उसके बावजूद हिंदुस्तान की सियासत में और हिंदुस्तान के जो नेशन बिल्डिंग है, हिंदुस्तान को एक मॉडर्न इंस्टीट्यूशन, एक मॉडर्न कंट्री बनाने में उनका बड़ा रोल है। आपको लग रहा होगा कि ये बातें मतलब ये पहले कभी नहीं सुनी, हकीकत में देवगौड़ा साहब के बारे में ये बातें पहले नहीं होती हैं, लेकिन अब जब एक नई किताब, एक बायोग्राफी उनके बारे में आई है जो कि लगभग 600 पेजेस पर मुश्तमिल है, 600 पेजेस की किताब है, उसमें बहुत सारे ऐसे पहलू जिससे हम और पूरा हिंदुस्तान और वाकिफ नहीं है, उसकी तरफ, उस पर रोशनी पड़ रही है। देवगौड़ा साहब के पॉलिटिकल जर्नी और पॉलिटिक्स में उनके कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन, हिंदुस्तान की नेशन बिल्डिंग में उनका कंट्रीब्यूशन, इन चीज़ों पर बात करने के लिए आज हमारे साथ सीनियर जर्नलिस्ट और एडिटर सुगाता श्रीनिवास राजू हमारे साथ हैं। सुगाता ने अभी हाल में वो किताब लिखी जिसका जिसके बारे में मैंने जिक्र किया, इस किताब का नाम है फरोज इन अ फील्ड। ये किताब और इसका सब टाइटल है द अनएक्सप्लोर्ड लाइफ ऑफ एच डी देवगौड़ा, तो हम इसके बारे में बात करेंगे। सुगाता,
थैंक यू माता।
सबसे पहला जो सवाल, शायद ऑब्वियस क्वेश्चन है, वो ये कि क्यों हुआ ऐसा कि उनके बारे में ज़्यादा बात नहीं हुई, और जब भी उनके बारे में बात हुई तो एक ख़ास तरह की बात हुई, और ये सिर्फ नेशनल लेवल पर नहीं बल्कि आपने किताब में लिखा भी है कि कर्नाटक में भी, जहाँ के वो हैं और जहाँ उनका 7 decades कह सकते हैं कि 70 साल लगभग पॉलिटिकल लाइफ रही है, वहाँ भी उनको एक ख़ास नज़रिए से देखा जाता है। तो उसकी पहली बात तो मैं ये जानना चाहता हूँ कि इसकी असल वजह क्या है।
नो, इट्स वेरी अनफॉर्चुनेट दैट पीपल रियली डिड नॉट फोकस ऑन हिज वर्क। देयर आर सेवरल रीजंस, यू नो, आई रिकाउंट अ फ्यू रीजंस इन द बुक। मेरा हिंदी इतना बढ़िया नहीं है, इसीलिए मैं थोड़ा इंग्लिश भी मिक्स करके बात कर रहा हूँ, तो मुझे थोड़ा क्षमा कीजिए इसके बारे में। सो देर आर सेवरल रीजन्स फॉर दैट, यू नो, आई मीन, देवेगौड़ा वॉज ऑलवेज एसोसिएटेड विद पावर पॉलिटिक्स एंड ही वॉज ऑलवेज सीन हैज समबडीज राइवल ट्राइंग टू सॉर्ट ऑफ, यू नो, मीन, फाइट रामकृष्ण हेगडे। सो ही वॉज सीन एज रामकृष्ण हेगडेज राइवल, बट नॉट सीन एज अ राइवल, नॉट सीन एज अ लीडर of his own, with his own, you know, I mean, credentials and stature and all that. And it's very, very ironic, Mahtab, that he was seen as Ramakrishna Hegde's rival and someone who tried to unseat him, or, you know, I mean, threw up scams against him and all that. But Ramakrishna Hegde was not a mass leader in Karnataka. Devegowda was, by the virtue of his, not just because he belonged to a dominant community in Karnataka, the Okkaligas, but also because he was the patriarch of the Kaveri Basin. He had fought for the rights of the people's, Kaveri water rights, for 3-4 decades before he became a chief minister in Karnataka. So he was a patriarch of the Kaveri Basin, and he was not just a peddler of power and, playing the electoral game. So he was a man who had always spoken about his ideas very, very eloquently in the Legislative Assembly and outside as well. See, he has been a legislator from 62 on, And you will be surprised, the very first speech that he makes in the Lok Sabha, in the Karnataka Legislative Assembly, is on his vision for Kaveri. You know, I mean, the harnessing of the Kaveri river water in Karnataka, a lot of the projects remained incomplete. In fact, there was a lot of legal problems involved and all that. See, Devegowda sorted out all those knotty problems over 3 or 4 decades. And therefore, he was a very, very big leader who was mixing, of course, caste politics. He was playing the power game. There is no doubt about that. But he was also coming with a solid vision. And he had a bouquet of ideas as to why he needs to be elected, why he needs to be on the chair. See, you don't often see leaders making this argument as to why they should be elected and what they will do. You know, I mean, it's become a money game, it's become something else now. But Devegowda was part of another generation where ideas were extremely important, and Karnataka was a very progressive state. Socialist politics was, you know, at its helm, and a lot of socialist leaders were doing really great work. And at least, you know, I mean, they were talking eloquently about a lot of things. And Devraj Aras was a very, very big guy. You know, I mean, he was a congressman, but I think socialists and communists had to learn a lot from him, because his pro-people agenda was so strong that the 8 years or 8.5 years that he was the chief minister of Karnataka saw a completely different Karnataka, and it sent a completely different roadmap for Karnataka. He was a great administrator, and Devegowda was, as a young Devegowda, you know, at 40, was thrust into a role of being his opposition leader, and he learns on the job. And he's by default, he's also the chairman of the Public Accounts Committee. And he's scrutinizing papers, learning to read papers, and trying to chip off the halo of a Devraj Aras, a mighty figure like Devraj Aras. So the question that you asked, why is his legacy not discussed?
Or yeah.
Why is it not spoken about so eloquently? One, he never invested in public relations. I don't think if there is one politician in India who has reached such a height, was not invested a single penny on public relations or image management, I think you can clearly say it is Devegowda. So that is one thing, one part of the thing. Two, he was a Shudra. He was lower down. He was not a Dalit. See, he's from an intermediate caste. But then the cultural capital a Shudra will have is very, very limited.
Yeah.
And the media or the social environment was dominated by the upper castes.
Yeah.
As it is today, it was also then. So Devegowda may have come from a very dominant caste, electorally a caste that was extremely important. But I think he was used like the ox. And there was another fox which was trying to make use of this ox. In fact, this ox and fox metaphor is constantly used in Karnataka to speak about Devegowda, who is the ox, who is the hard-working guy, who is working, building the party, bringing the party to power, and somebody else comes and sits on the chair the moment the party has won the elections. So the fox was the reference to Mr. Ramakrishna Hegde. And this is the analogy that Mr. P. Lankesh, Gauri's father, created in his tabloid.
Yeah.
So one was an ox and another one was a fox. And this ox and fox, I don't need to tell you anything more.
Yeah.
So he was the hardworking kind. So the sweat was his, but you know, I mean, he was outmaneuvered many times. So that is one reason. The second thing is, of course, he was not from the Anglophone world. The Anglophone world and the Anglophone elite, which we have now sort of designated them as Lutens, you know, Delhiites, or the Khan Market gang, or whatever, you know, the recent kind of appendages that we have tried to create. So, I mean, even back then, I think the Anglophone elite had a way of, you know, I mean, picking people and celebrating. And Devegowda was not part of that group. He was a rank outsider to every possible combination that existed in Indian politics at that point of time. So that is the second disadvantage. And the third was the fact that he was from the south of India.
Yeah.
So in fact, you know, I mean, I mentioned in my book that it is such an unfortunate thing that when Devegowda becomes prime minister, a very important book is published in English, and it's called The Idea of India, and which is, that phrase has become very, very common now amongst the liberal,
yes,
intelligentsia. And that book was written by Sunil Kilnani, and he begins his first chapter with a sentence saying that Deve Gowda is India's prime minister and he knows neither English nor Hindi, which is a complete false thing to say, because it's a half-truth. At least his English, he had conducted his parliamentary business in English for 30 years by then. There were letters that he was writing to Morarji or Chandrasekhar or to Ramakrishna Hegde. All of that was in English. And he had gone to an English medium school. His father in Holenarsipur had gone around looking for a pastor to teach him English. So he's not great in English. He didn't speak the Queen's English. But then he was fairly acquainted with English. His spoken English may not have been great, but then his written English was decent. In fact, in my book, P. Chidambaram says that his English was fantastic. His English was very, very good. But I don't know why people spread this canard that he neither knew Hindi nor English. And Hindi also, I don't think, see, my Hindi is as good as his Hindi or any South Indian's Hindi, because we understand the language, but we don't feel confident enough to talk in that language.
Yeah.
Now you said you can talk in Hindi, but I don't feel confident because I'm very conscious of the fact that, I may make a mistake and a bloomer and, it may look sort of very bad. So he was dealing with national leaders at that point. It could be Chandrasekhar. He was very, very close to Chandrasekhar. He was dealing with Morarji. He was dealing with Jagjivan Ram. He had a very good relationship with Charan Singh. In fact, there is an episode, I think I mentioned somewhere in the book, that he and his wife go to Charan Singh's house and they're communicating in sign language and, using a bit of Dakini here and there. And see, that is the kind of thing, that is India actually. See, India is sort of categorized as some kind of a Hindi state or the Anglophone English try to make it their own in small pockets. But then India is so diverse, and Tamil or Bengali or Kannada are equally very, very big languages with 2,000 years of written literature and heritage. So I think it was very, very unfair. So these are some of the reasons: linguistic, geographic, caste and class. I think these are the reasons why Deve Gowda never got discussed. And of course, he did not know how to sort of break into it, because he never spent money on PR or public relations. And he wore a dhoti. That looked very odd to people. He ate ragi. That looked odd to people. Today, 25 years later, we are celebrating millets. We are speaking of desi khana and health food and all that. This man came 25 years and he looked very odd to people. So that's the sad part about it.
So it is interesting you spoke about him being a Shudra who became Prime Minister, him being from South India. So the question I have, and this is also something I wanted to ask, is he was not the first Prime Minister with a Shudra background. He was the second. You spoke about Charan Singh also. Similarly, he was not the first Prime Minister from the South. So my question is, what is the difference between, say, H.D. Dev Gowda and P.V. Narasimha Rao? What is the difference between Charan Singh, Chaudhary Charan Singh and H.D. Dev Gowda?
See, in the case of, I'll start with P.V. Narasimha Rao.
Yes.
See, P.V. Narasimha Rao had left Andhra Pradesh by 71, 72. I think he was the Chief Minister around the early years of the 70s. Early 70s. And then he had become part of the Delhi establishment. I don't think he had a deep connect with Andhra Pradesh, the undivided Andhra Pradesh. And he had become part of the Delhi establishment. And he was a Brahmin.
Yeah.
He had cultural capital. And he was, there were several cases against him, corruption cases and that and this and everything. People always spoke of him as a scholar.
His intellect and his knowledge, several languages.
Seven languages, Chanakyan kind of thing. So you never attributed those, you never sort of used those adjectives for a Deve Gowda who had survived 60, 70 years in politics. Or even after stepping down as Prime Minister, 25 years, is still relevant in Karnataka. You can't do politics in Karnataka without taking Deve Gowda into consideration. How many political parties in India have consistently retained a vote share of 20% for 25 years. Deve Gowda built a party which retains that vote base in Karnataka, and which is not a small achievement. So with when it came to P.V. Narasimhan, whom he was very, very close to, I think he had he almost saw him as a very dear friend and a kind of guru. So, but there was this cultural capital, the issue of cultural capital. He was a Brahmin, he was seen as somebody else, he was part of the Delhi establishment. He knew how to work the Delhi establishment. So P.V. Narasimha was a different, he was technically a South Indian. But I don't think he was, he had sort of, you know, carried that thing very, very strongly. And he could speak in Hindi, he could speak in Urdu, he could speak in English, could speak a dozen other languages. So I don't think for him, maneuvering or negotiating the alleys and labyrinths of Delhi was so very difficult, because he was very familiar with that.
And I think he was more metropolitan. He was from...
Yeah, he was not... I mean, actually, if you look at his biography, they try to create that kind of rural kind of... They try to tell you that he was invested quite a bit in rural Andhra Pradesh. But we had a very, very rural-centric economy then. So you could not have escaped that. And there was the India that we speak of today did not exist then. So obviously he had to have had some relationship. He was a landlord.
Yeah.
Hundreds of acres of land. Devegowda was not that. Devegowda's father had 4 ragged acres and he had to take care of so many children. And he was a very melancholic character. So Devegowda neither had real capital or cultural capital or social capital.
Yeah.
Narasimha Rao had everything going for him.
And Devegowda's parents were illiterate.
He's a first generation.
Yeah.
So they were unlettered.
Unlettered.
And he was the first generation literate in the family. And he was the first one to go to school in that family. So there were, you can't compare, it's apples and oranges.
Yeah.
You can't compare Narasimha Rao with Devegowda at all, because they are worlds apart. And when it comes to Charan Singh,
See,
Charan Singh was an Arya Samajist.
Yes.
Charan Singh also was highly educated. Nobody speaks about the volumes that Charan Singh has written on economics and agriculture.
Yes.
Very, very scholarly books.
Yeah.
Again, he has been condemned to the dustbin of history as some odd character, someone, you know, who played the farmers.
He also wore dhoti. And
yes,
dhoti
absolutely. And he conducted darbars every morning. And people came and sat on their haunches and spoke to him. And he was more a patriarchal kind of a figure. Devegowda was not even a patriarchal figure. No, the patriarchy...
You call him a reluctant patriarch.
He was a reluctant patriarch.
Yes.
No, that's for very different reasons within the family that I call him a reluctant patriarch. But with Charan Singh, he was not exactly a Shudra. See, the Jat thing, he was a Jat.
Yes.
And Jat people had a lot of capital, social capital. And he came from a family which was very, very different from that of a Devegowda. So he may have been technically a Shudra,
OBC.
An OBC, but he did not even face parliament.
Yeah.
See, Charan Singh was the only prime minister who did not face parliament. So he had to was not confirmed by parliament at all. He didn't face a vote of confidence. So that way, Devegowda was a prime minister who faced the parliament, who won his vote of confidence, and then was there on the chair for nearly 11 months. There's a lot of difference. And Charan Singh, even if you did not know English or if you did not know any other Indian language, by the fact that you knew Hindi was enough to survive.
Yes.
And you came from a state like Uttar Pradesh, which had so many seats. And Uttar Pradesh had the reputation of sending prime ministers to Delhi. So Charan Singh had a kind of set thing, you know, and he was there, and he had already see the kind of administrative experience that Charan Singh had. He had worked with Govindwala Pant. He had actually worked on an APMC legislation way back then. He had looked at land reforms. And he was a very scholarly kind of a person. And for Devegowda, all of that was learning on the job. He sat down at night, studied papers, tried to understand, self-taught completely.
But it was not an accident. I mean, self-education was not some accidental thing. He tried for it.
Yes, of course. See, that is the thing. If you speak to any earlier generation of politicians in Karnataka, they will tell you one thing. That they will say that Devegowda woke up around 3:30, 4 in the morning and would read till the break of dawn. So he was... अध्ययनशील
okay.
A prime minister who actually read and but he hid his reading.
Yeah.
He was very, very conscious of his mass image that he hid his reading. In fact, in the book, at one point, I say he, once when he was talking in parliament, he suddenly forgets this put on kind of a thing
yeah.
and starts speaking about Stiglitz and the new book that he has written and his policy and suddenly withdraws, suddenly starts saying something else. So, I think he's someone who I feel, in my interactions and he's extremely well-read. In fact, I've never seen him without a book. And when the China crisis was happening in 2019 and all that, he was making notes furiously. I don't know, I asked him one day, so you're making these notes, you're making these margin notes and you're writing down a lot of these things. Where are you going to use it? He said, no, that is how I have been. That's my process. That's how I sort of, understand things. If I don't make notes, it doesn't get into me. So I've always done that and continue to do that.
And he's very hardworking. And
yes.
He's not the only prime minister who's been working 18 hours or...
No. Devegowda, in fact, worked so hard. He has this belief in astrology and somebody had told him that his tenure will be very short, about which I write. So he tells his man who's going to be his joint secretary in the PMO that let's go with just one suitcase.
Yes.
He was his principal secretary as chief minister. So he had this kind of thing that he knew that he wouldn't last for too long.
Yeah.
So he tried to work very hard and he had made it a habit ever since he was a legislator, from the 70s as an opposition leader, that he would wake up very early in the morning to read the PAC papers. That is where he started looking at legal documents, parliamentary papers and all that very, very seriously. In fact, you will be surprised. I mentioned this in the book, H.Y. Sharda Prasad.
Yes.
Who was Indira Gandhi's information advisor
yes.
and also Rajiv Gandhi's information advisor and for a short period, even Morarji's information advisor, tells me that if Indira Gandhi knew as much law as Devegowda, she wouldn't have clamped the emergency. See, that's a huge endorsement. That is because Devegowda fought litigations at every level. District court, sessions court, high court, supreme court, a very litigious person. So his understanding of the law comes from a fighting in the court, actually, fighting. By filing cases, by sort of, asking for revisions, for certain judgments and all that. He actually functions like a public interest litigator.
Yeah, much before it was.
It became very famous. So all through his career, I have quoted some Supreme Court lawyers who have worked with him or seen him very closely. And they say that he knew every lawyer in the High Court of Karnataka. And he knew whom to deploy for which case. And his knowledge of the courts in Karnataka was so immense that he would tell you who passed the judgment on which day and who was standing there and arguing what. So that was the kind of... See, it is by experience and investing a lot of his energy in trying to understand a problem. So his learning and reading also had a purpose. It was not for pleasure. It was not... See, he did not belong to a pastoral society where he just laid back and read novels and all that. That is a different kind of society. He studied so that he could make use of it the next day morning. In fact, when he goes to meet Sundaralal Bahuguna, he tells him about a geologist he has read and he said, I can create many mini hydel projects here which will solve the problem of the entire subcontinent. So, and he sort of, is having a conversation at a very different level with Sundaralal Bahuguna. So people are amazed that this man has such fine understanding. In fact, a lawyer, a Supreme Court lawyer whom I speak about, and even people like Nariman, they think that he was very, very thorough with river basin planning. And it is that idea and that expertise in river basin planning which helps him solve the Faraka crisis. That Faraka treaty, which was languishing or which was not inked and which was creating a lot of problem, Devegowda just solves it in a week's time or a fortnight's time, convinces Jyoti Basu, convinces Sheikh Hasina, and just goes ahead and does this treaty in December of 1996, so which has stood the test of time. A lot of water treaties don't, but then I have quoted experts from Bangladesh, the river water experts from Bangladesh, and they say that it's unfortunate that he signed that treaty only for 30 years. It expires 5 years later and we don't know what's going to happen. But then the kind of formula that he created was so thorough, was so good, that it sort of stood the test of time.
Yeah. So he became the Prime Minister in 1996.
Yes.
And that was the first time, and that was the time also when he had become the Chief Minister for the first time after trying for 5 times.
Yes, 5 times.
So what I gathered from reading, that he was indeed a reluctant Prime Minister. He never wanted to become the Prime Minister. But this was not the first time when the proposal, it was proposed that he should become Prime Minister.
Yeah,
so this was the second time, right?
No, Basu's it was the second time. Devegowda it was the first time.
Okay.
Basu actually,
when the Chandrasekhar crisis happens after VP Singh,
yeah,
the offer is made to Basu, and this Basu mentions this in his oral archives,
yes,
which is in the Nehru Memorial Library and the oral archives there. But for Devegowda, he was a reluctant Prime Minister. I think your reading is bang on. He was a reluctant Prime Minister. His ambition was to, rule Karnataka for 20, 25 years like Basu.
Yes.
So when the proposal is made to him, he sort of catches hold of Basu's feet and he says, "Why are you killing my career, sir? I want to be like you. You're like my elder brother. And why don't you sort of allow me to continue as the Chief Minister?" So Basu gets a little upset. He says, "See, can I go out?" Basu's party has already refused his nomination. And he says, "Do you want me to go and put out an advertisement saying that we need a secular Prime Minister to fight Vajpayee?"
Yeah.
So he just turns to Lalu Prasad Yadav and he says, "Go and announce."
Yeah.
So Devegowda does not know what to do. And because he respects Basu a lot, and they just go ahead. He just accepts it. He has to accept it. But he was a reluctant Prime Minister.
And his wife was very unhappy that he has accepted.
Absolutely, absolutely. Because he had struggled from 78 was his first chance to become Chief Minister. That is the post-emergency election. Every state, a non-BJP, non-Congress government comes to power in many states.
Janata Party.
And he's the president of the Janata Party. The election is fought on his name. And there is some harakiri that happens, which I speak about in the book. And in 78, he does not become the Chief Minister. But everybody thought he would become the Chief Minister in 78. Again, 83, he misses the chance. Again, in between, sometime around 86, when Hegde decides to resign and then takes back his resignation, his name again comes up to be Chief Minister. And then Bommai becomes. Hegde and others, play a...
Current Chief Minister's father.
Father, yeah. Suraj Bommai's father. So he's lost out 4 or 5 times. And then finally he has become Chief Minister in 94, December.
Yeah.
And he's got such a massive mandate and he's very, very popular. All that he's planning and proposing is going really well. And this comes up. And the family is unhappy. Devegowda is unsure and reluctant. But then this historic situation is such that he sort of had to accept the Prime Ministership.
Yeah. What I also gathered from the book that he is a deeply religious man.
Yes.
But at the same time, he's not a fundamentalist or who indulged in doing politics on religious line.
That is right.
I mean, he did politics and it was, I think, it was not possible to ignore caste thing in Karnataka, because Karnataka was indeed
is indeed a very ridden
caste. So can you just shed some light on that?
Yeah, I mean, that is a very, very, very complex kind of a thing about Devegowda.
Yeah.
He's deeply religious, doesn't step out of his house without an hour of puja, doesn't step out at an inauspicious moment. He's very ritualistic, very, very, superstitious also, and deeply religious. And there is also a layer of spiritualism, which of course I have not written much about. But then there is a spiritual element also. But it's very surprising that he never mixed religion with politics. That separation has been very clear. And I don't think there is any other Indian politician today who wears a skull cap, even at this age. It's a practice. For all Muslim festivals, he goes and does prayer with his Muslim friends. He goes and sits in the line and he just prays with a skull cap on. So, I mean, he has been that way. It's very difficult to explain. And I asked him this question.
Yeah.
See, a lot of people would have pontificated. They would have said, no, I read this, I read that. And they would have quoted the Constitution. They would have quoted their belief in the Constitution and Ambedkar and all that. But he said something very, very interesting and very, yet personalized it, the whole thing. He said, see, when I was growing up, my father had a Muslim person as a hand, helping hand in the fields. And he used to be very nice to me. He taught me how to write Urdu. I mean, whatever little tutorials that the man gave, he was very kind to me. So my idea of a Muslim, sort of changed. Nobody in the first place told him that a Muslim is different from you because they were part of the community.
Yeah.
And then when he goes to Hassan and he does not get his, I write about this.
Yes.
He does not get a hostel
because of
accommodation
his
because of his caste. And also because there are some, the elite Okaligas have laid siege over those seats.
Okay.
And he has to find a small little room to stay. So he finds a small little room, which is an outhouse of a Muslim household. And those people look after him so well, they treat him like a son. So then he asked me, he turned around and asked me, when people have been so kind to me, how can I discriminate on the basis of their caste? See, that day, if that family did not look after me or feed me or give me accommodation, I wouldn't have reached here. If that man who was my father's hand in the fields did not sort of look at me kindly and, treat me so well, I think it's personal experience of, with people which has shaped him. So I don't think it's theoretical. The answer of being a secular, constitutional secularist, he's not a constitutional secularist.
He's an organic
secularist. He's an organic secularist. Yeah. That is my reading.
Yeah. So Dev Gowda is a very, deeply religious man. But he also decides when anti-Muslim violence happened in 2002 during Vajpayee regime, he decides to go without, making fanfare of it and decides to go to, visit camps where refugee camps in Gujarat.
Yes.
And then write letters also. There is a chapter in your book about his relationship and his letters to Vajpayee and his speech in parliament. So, and then we also, his party, which has name suffix as secular, Janata Dal Secular, it decides to be part of, government, which is, with BJP. So how do you see this transformation? What was the reason behind it?
Well, that's right. See, 2002, he's back in parliament. He has lost the 99 election.
Yes.
He's come back to parliament in February of 2002 and the riots break out. So he's so upset. He has an SPG as a former prime minister. With his SPG cover, he goes to Godhra alone with his security or whatever and goes around the Muslim camps and he is completely shaken by what he's seeing. And from there, he writes to Vajpayee at least 3 or 4 letters which I could lay my hands on. See, he's not a very organized man. He's not kept all of these stuff. And a lot of these are official letters that he wrote. So they were sort of dated and sealed and whatever. So he writes these angry letters and he's the first one who says that this is state-sponsored terrorism. Nothing less than that. And he never released these letters, I don't know for what reason. Probably because he spoke very eloquently on the subject, even in the parliament. He says, I'm ashamed, I'm really disappointed that I thought you're a very, very different person, Vajpayee, but then you're not that. So you have to act, you have to sort of, go ahead and do these things and protect the fabric of our society. This is completely being torn apart in Godhra. And those things, you know, I mean, were never discussed. I don't know why. And those were all, you know, they were available in the public, they're in the public domain, and I picked it up from the public domain. But nobody had ever spoken about these letters to Vajpayee. Of course, the letters could have, you know, I mean, people may not have accessed it, but his parliamentary speeches were there. Yeah. He spoke for 55 minutes on Godhra, and I think that was the longest speech that he made. But people who wrote on the whole thing never ever sort of cited the very harsh speeches he had made in parliament. You then speak about 2004, that is post-2004, that is in Karnataka, his party has come to power with the Congress, and by 2006 his son is defecting and goes with Janata Dal. Janata Dal S goes with the BJP, and his son also asks, what is secularism? That is a moment in Devegowda's life where he sort of gets into clinical depression because of what happened. He had lost control over his party, and he had also lost control over his MLAs and his son. I discussed that particular thing, although the book stops at 2004, I knew that people will be very, very curious about that particular episode. So I discussed that. Devegowda lost control of his thing. So when he actually gets into a state where he has not spoken for several weeks, and he's become very violent, anybody trying to touch him or trying to feed him, he's just violently shaking them off, shaking his body off, and then pushing them away, and all of that is happening. So then there is a therapy process that is organized. The son is made to come and stand in front of him. The family arranges that because they think that he will just, you know, I mean, he's not eating. So they think that he will sort of, you know, this is health will decline, and it may be a very, very bad situation. So he's even taken to the hospital in the middle of the night because his vitals fall. So all of that happens, and that was a very, very low point in his life. And I write there, doctors tell me that his gait changed after that incident. He never stood erect. So that was a kind of observation that the doctors made, that he sort of became, he bent a little. You know, I mean, his gait was not so perfect. He otherwise used to be a man who stood straight and looked people into the eyes. So I think that psychologically affected him very, very deeply. And that reconciliation was not a very easy reconciliation. And the son has also admitted later that he gave his father a lot of pain. And in 2019, Modi makes an offer to his son,
yeah,
and tells him that we'll partner, and the Congress is anyway going to pull your government down, so don't trust them, you come with us. So he says, no, I've made a mistake once, and my father is in his last leg. This is the last stretch of his life. I don't want to hurt him again. So even if they sort of pull the rug, let them do that. So that is also something that happens. And that is because the son has seen what the father went through. It's not that the son regretted it at that point of time.
Yes.
But then I think he probably has also, I think people change.
Yeah.
He must have changed. But it was a very, very low point in Devegowda's life.
It was largely H.D. Kumaraswamy's decision.
Yeah, yeah. It's very well known in Karnataka, the kind of people who plotted, the kind of people he kept company, what has happened to those people today. See, all of that is very well known. And Kumaraswamy actually did it upfront. You know, he sort of came out and did it. But there are people in the Congress today who just back off their 17 close MLAs who are their closest of their followers to the BJP and pull down the government in Karnataka. So some people do it slyly, some people do it in a brazen fashion. The brazen ones get branded. The ones who do it slyly are never sort of questioned or whatever. So it's that.
And this includes the tallest leaders of
absolutely
Hegde.
Absolutely. And I have to tell you this, Mahtab, there is a misconception that it was Kumaraswamy who defected and created space for BJP. No, it happened in 99. The tallest socialist leaders went with the BJP.
Yeah.
Hegde become part of Vajpayee's government because his Lok Shakti party in Karnataka had an electoral alliance with the BJP. So they create a bigger space for BJP in Karnataka first. J.H. Patel, who's a known socialist, goes with his friend George Fernandez.
Yeah.
All these socialists and the JD, and they form the JDU. And they have a alliance with the BJP. So the, if you look at the vote shares, it's very, very clear that the first such thing that in Karnataka was not 2005-06 when Kumaraswamy defects. It was actually Hegde's defection from the Janata Party and the Janata Dal. And I mean, of course, he was expelled. We can't blame him. But then it was they who sort of primarily to defeat Devegowda go with the BJP and create a larger base. See, they were all very elderly leaders. They were all in their last leg. And once they died, see, Hegde died in 2004.
Yeah.
Bommai goes away. And then Patel also dies very soon. The moment that vacuum was there, Yediyurappa sort of filled up that vacuum.
Yeah.
So that is how BJP got the vote share of the earlier Janata Dal and consolidated itself. So Kumaraswamy comes much later, but this saga has happened in 99. In fact, Professor Madhu Dandavate works very hard, you know, I mean, tries to convince a lot of these people not to do this. But they go against all that and they sort of get into an alliance. And we speak so much about this episode about Devegowda. But why is it that we don't speak about a Karunanidhi aligning with the BJP? We don't speak about a JDU aligning with the BJP. We don't speak about a Mamata aligning with the BJP. They're all never questioned of their secular credentials.
BSP aligning.
BSP aligning with the BJP.
Yeah.
So their secular credentials are never questioned. Only Devegowda is sort of, you know, questioned on his this whole thing. And the fact is that he went into clinical depression when his son backstabs him on this particular issue.
Thank you, Sugata.
Pleasure.
Get a sneak peek of exclusive content before everyone else, for channel members only. Memberships start at ₹89. Hit the join button below.